Today we have with us Dr. Kirti presenting on connective tissue disorders, interstitial lung disease. You're good to go, Kirti. Continue.
Thank you, sir. In the outset, I would like to thank Karnataka Pulmonologist Association for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be a part of an excellent initiative that is directed towards the PGs. The topic that I will be discussing today is connective tissue disorder associated interstitial lung disease. Good evening, everybody. I am Dr. Deepti Sharma. I am a SR at the Department of Pulmonary Medicine, Kasturba Medical College, Mahim, Mangalore. This is an overview of what I will be discussing. In the introduction, we will be seeing the numbers and the percentages and the kind of CTDs we get to see in the day-to-day basis. Next, we'll go to the general evaluation of the ILDs in CTDs. And then we'll discuss about the particular type of ILDs that are specifically seen in CTDs. And then finally, disease-wise discussions will be carried out. Connective tissue disorders, also called as collagen vascular disorders, are a spectrum of systemic autoimmune disorders that is characterized by circulating autoantibodies, immune-mediated organ damage, and a wide spectrum of clinical manifestation. In an Indian setup, the major CTDs that we come across is rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, scleroderma, Sjögren syndrome, mixed connective tissue disorder, polymyositis, dermatomyositis, and ankylosing spondylitis. The connective tissue disorder, which I'll now be referring to as CTDs, is often associated with pulmonary complication. Most of this pulmonary complication appear in a pre-established disease of a connective tissue disorder, but in some, it may precede a systemic manifestation. This occurs especially in cases of rheumatoid arthritis, polymyositis, dermatomyositis, and scleroderma. CTDs can involve any structure in the respiratory system. It can either be respiratory muscles or the pleura or the conducting airways or the lung parenchyma itself, including the small airways, interstitium, and pulmonary vessels. Let us now see a plethora of pathology that we see in the CTD. Interstitial lung diseases, vascular abnormalities, which can be either primary or secondary. Primary, there will be plexogenic arteriopathy, whereas in secondary to the hypoxemia, there will be medial hypertrophy of the pulmonary vessels. Diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, which is one of the acute and the most dangerous complications of the CTD in the pulmonary pathology, mostly seen in SLE. Bronchiolitis, mostly seen in smokers and rheumatoid arthritis. Parenchymal nodules, also called as necrobiotic nodule, again typically seen in rheumatoid arthritis. And other parts can also be involved, including pleural effusion, respiratory muscle dysfunction. Now, given the topic that is given to me, we'll be exclusively discussing about the interstitial lung diseases. In CTDs, the interstitial lung diseases mainly come in five categories. Usual interstitial pattern UIP, non-specific interstitial pneumonia NSIP, lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia LIP, diffuse alveolar damage, and organizing pneumonia. These are not mutually exclusive. So interstitial disease can also come along with other pathologies such as bronchiolitis and parenchymal nodules. ILD in CTD. It is often difficult to distinguish, especially in a pre-established CTD, whether the disease is because of the primary interstitial complications itself or it is secondary to the immunosuppressants which is being given for the treatment and the cytotoxic effects of those drugs, especially when methotrexate and gold substances are used. ILD occurs in about 15% of the CTD in general and as high as about 60% in systemic sclerosis. The ILD Registry of India documents 13.9% of CTD ILD among all the ILD patients in India, which comes next to the hypersensitive pneumonitis. It is interesting to see that the CTD ILD surpasses the IPF numbers in India. ILD can present as a first or primary manifestation in CTD patients. So why do we assess for ILD? Now there are three implications, the first and foremost being the treatment. Now the approach to the treatment will differ as soon as we know that the patient is having CTD. Why? If the patient is coming with a UIP pattern and if it is the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, the mode of management will go more towards antifibrotics. We go with pirfenidone, nintedanib, and supportive medications. These patients become eligible for lung transplantation. Whereas if you get a serology done, if there are other systemic symptoms and you diagnose them of CTD, the mode of management goes towards immunosuppression. There is another entity called as interstitial pneumonia with autoimmune features, which basically comes with no systemic symptoms, the serology will be positive and they'll be having interstitial infiltrates. Now, after complete evaluation, these patients can also undergo immunosuppression. Now, the second implication is prognosis. Any patient of CTD who is having the ILD will carry a worse prognosis as compared to those with the other systemic disorders. The third implication includes the extrathoracic disease, which, as I told you, can also be associated with the interstitial lung disease. So during follow-up and prognostication, we need to know if the symptom is caused just by the ILD or by the other symptoms such as pleural effusion and muscle disorders. How do we assess the presence and extent of impact? CTD-ILD usually follows a multidisciplinary approach. Either the patient is referred to us to a pulmonology clinic from a rheumatology or a general physician, or we get it as a primary complaint. The most common symptoms which these patients come with is progressive exertional dyspnea. Now, this can be either because of just the ILD itself or because of the associated symptoms along with that. Probably because of immunosuppression, the patient will have pneumonia, or they'll be coming with the alveolar hemorrhage, or they'll be having bronchiolitis. The second symptom which they come with is a cough. Especially in patients with systemic sclerosis, the patient might be having cough secondary to the GERD and the regurgitation symptoms, or because of the anemia and the pulmonary hypertension itself. On physical examination of respiratory system, the patients are found to have bibacillar crackles, and on systemic examination, we may find certain skin changes, certain nodules which are present. Now, the skin changes may not correlate with that of the ILD features. Risk factor and CTD phenotyping is specific to patients who are not been diagnosed of CTD. Anytime you see a patient who is having history of family history of CTDs, if he's a smoker, if there has been any previous carcinomas, and in CTD phenotyping, we go ahead and do a serological testing for ANA profile. Physiological assessment of the pulmonary function becomes very, very important in these patients at the time of diagnosis and also in follow-up. The most important parameter that we look for in a PFT is FVC, because it is more reliable and easily repeatable and very valid. The second one, what you can do is a DLCO can be done mainly to see the diffusion capacity and the involvement of interstitium. Pulmonary physiology plays a very important role and is highly sensitive both in resting as well as in exercise state. So 6-minute walk test becomes very valuable in this point. Coming to HRCT thorax imaging, HRCT thorax has now become a standard screening technique for patients with ILD and CTDs. Most of the time, by the time we reach HRCT thorax, we are quite sure of the diagnosis and we can go ahead with the treatment. But in case if you're having any confusion or if the symptoms is not fitting well with the ILD, or if you're suspecting 2 to 3 pathologies are involved, then and only then we'll undergo any invasive procedure in this patient. When bronchoscopy is done, bile is taken out mainly for cytology, for cellular differential counts, and also for cultures to rule out any infection with patients on immunosuppressants. The chances of them going for surgical lung biopsy is very rare. So how do we treat interstitial lung disease in CTDs? The optimal time for the treatment of ILD is studied exclusively only in systemic sclerosis. And the treatment of CTD-ILD is similar to that of the patient with CTD. Now, the treatment of CTD itself is a double-edged sword. So some treatment which you are giving, especially the immunosuppressive agents, have a certain degree of toxicity which itself might lead to interstitial lung diseases. So in limited disease, the risk ratio or benefit ratio favors to a careful observation. You don't have to treat the ILD specifically. Whereas the threshold for initiating a treatment is reduced in 3 conditions. When you're doing a HRCT and there is a severe ILD, or in a PFT or regular follow-up, there is worsening of clinical symptoms and lung functions, or in a recent onset of systemic disease. Now, this becomes specific to scleroderma. Prevalence of ILD in CTD. Most of this patient, almost 45 to 50% of a systemic sclerosis patient end up having some form of ILD. The most common form of ILD in CTD will be NSIP. The exception being rheumatoid arthritis, which is more commonly seen in Indian clinics, UIP will be the common pattern. Almost 7 to 10% of them will have some form of ILD. Systemic lupus erythematosus, notorious to cause pleuroparenchymal manifestation, 11 to 12% of them will have ILD. And lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia, organizing pneumonia will also be seen in this patient. Sjögren syndrome, almost 15% of them will have. And polymyositis, dermatomyositis, the more papers are connected towards Southeast Asian patients, so the percentage goes high up to almost 70-78% in these patients. MCTDs, almost 50 to 60% of the patients will have NSIP. Now coming to the ILD pattern in specific, I'll be dividing and discussing in 2 parts, HRCT and the histopathological features. Come into the first one, usual interstitial pneumonia pattern, also called as UIP. We have four criteria, as we already know, how to diagnose a UIP in a HRCT. First and foremost, they should have a picobasal gradient where there is subpleural and basal predominance. The opacities which are seen are usually reticular opacities, which is linear mesh-like opacities. Honeycombing will be present with or without traction bronchiectasis. Honeycombing is nothing but 2 to 3 millimeter sized cysts stacked one upon other. Now, absence of findings inconsistent with UIP is also important, such as there should not be any consolidation, any macrocysts, any malignancies, or any peribronchovascular predominance, upper lobe, middle lobe predominance. If there is mosaic attenuation, it should be at least less than 30% for us to diagnose as a UIP. Histopathologically, the most important point to be seen in HP is architectural distortion. Now, this will be secondary to the mononuclear cell infiltration and also because of the fibroblast proliferation, which causes collagen deposition. Now, this collagen deposition will also cause something called as a hobnailed appearance. That is, type 2 cell hyperplasia will be present. Honeycombing will also be seen in a histopathology, and the other special feature, which is separates CTD-ILD from that of IPFS, focal chronic pleuritis, lymphoid follicles, and perivascular collagen deposition. The second one, NSIP. As the name suggests, non-specific interstitial marking will be present. Predominantly, it will be ground glass opacity, which is attenuation where the vessel markings are still visible in the HRCT. Reticular opacities will be there with or without traction bronchiectasis. It will be usually patchy or peribronchovascular distribution. There will be no epicobasal gradient. On histopathology, there are three important types: cellular, fibrotic, and mixed. Cellular, as the name suggests, will have a lot of lymphoplasmacytic infiltrates and increased type 2 epithelial cell hyperplasia. The fibrotic one is quite dangerous and has got a poorer prognosis when we find this out in a patient. There will be temporal and spatial collagen deposition and leads to architectural distortion. Patients with FNSIP tend to turn towards UIP and have a worse prognosis and have a higher mortality rate. Organizing pneumonia, most of the time there will be airspace consolidation, mostly peripheral and random distribution. There will be ground glass opacities and centrilobular nodules. Histopathologically, there will be three features. There will be something called as Mason's bodies, which is intraalveolar space and ductal space fibroblastic proliferation. The proliferation might also cause something called as inflammatory polyp, which will protrude into the lumen, and also the alveolar septal infiltration will be seen. Diffuse alveolar damage. One of the most dangerous acute presentation in which the patient, we might lose the patient very early in the course of the disease. When a patient comes to emergency room, the patient will be having hypoxia, dyspnea. So immediately, most of the time, these patients end up going to ICU. But in case you have find time to get an early HRCT done, these patients tend to have scattered diffuse GGOs. Whereas in a late phase, you will see fibrosis and honeycombing. Histopathologically, mixed cellular infiltrates are seen. Intraalveolar hyaline membrane formation is seen, which is very typical of diffuse alveolar damage. And in severe cases, you'll also see RBCs. Lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia. As the name suggests, there will be lymphocytic infiltration in this kind of ILD. Diffuse centrilobular nodules and multiple thin walled cysts of varying sizes will be seen. Histopathologically, angiocentric distribution, that is a lymphocytic infiltration around the vessel, will be seen. There will be germinal center and granuloma formation. Amyloid deposition is also seen in these patients. Coming to the disease proper, now that we have discussed in general what do we do for CTD ILDs, we'll go into each disease particularly. Systemic sclerosis, also called as scleroderma. It is a chronic multisystem disease characterized by the deposition of excessive extracellular matrix and progressive fibrosis of both skin and the internal organs. Broadly divided into three categories: diffuse, as the name suggests, both the skin and the viscera will be involved. In limited disease, also known as CREST syndrome, where there is calcinosis, Raynaud's phenomenon, esophageal dysmotility, sclerodactyly, and telangiectasia. There is another form called as systemic sclerosis sinus scleroderma, where only the lung involvement and visceral organ involvement is seen, minus the skin involvement. It's the most extensively studied and evidence-based pharmacological management is given most appropriately for systemic sclerosis. What are the pulmonary manifestation? I'll be just listing out the pulmonary manifestation, giving more importance to the ILD features. ILD is seen in around 30 to 100% at some point of the disease in all this patient. The most common type, unfortunately, is the FNSIP pattern. Any scleroderma patient who is having an ILD associated with it will have a worse prognosis. In a limited disease, almost 25% of the patients will have ILD, whereas in a systemic diffuse disease, almost 50% of them will end up having the disease. Second, the pulmonary vascular disease is seen on almost 10%. Usually the primary type, the plephogenic arteriopathy is seen, and this is typically seen in the CREST syndrome. Aspiration pneumonia will be seen, which is attributed to the esophageal dysmotility and the regurgitation and the dilatation of the esophagus, especially in the limited variety. Pleural diseases and other system, other part involvement is quite rare. So how do you diagnose ILD and what do you do to monitor it? According to the ATCRS guidelines, the significant change in lung function is told to be FVC more than 10% change and DLCO more than 15% change. Now Goh et al. Presented a paper in 2008 where they tried to stage the disease depending upon two factors, the HRCT involvement and also the FVC. If the HRCT involvement is less than 10% along with the FVC of more than 70%, they termed it as limited disease. Whereas the HRCT involvement of more than 30% and the extensive disease with the FVC of less than 70%. If there is a confusion, they were termed as indeterminate. So once we get a HRCT, once we get a diagnosis, do we need to repeat it? Usually not required, but you will want to repeat the HRCT only when there is worsening in the symptoms or the functions which is not explained by the natural progression of the ILD in a patient, such as sudden worsening, sudden desaturation. So only then you'll get a CT done to rule out pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary embolism, infection and lung cancers. Treatment. As I already told you, it has been extensively studied. A scleroderma lung study, SLS, was published in 2006, which was a double-blind randomized placebo-controlled trial, which was carried out over a period of 1 year. One group was given 1 year of oral cyclophosphamide, where the other group was given placebo. Two parameters were checked, FVC and CT changes, and they found out that the worsening of the disease is reduced in patients with the cyclophosphamide treatment. A second follow-up study was done mainly to see the beneficial pharmacological effect of the cyclophosphamide past 2 years. It was published in 2016. It was a randomized double-blind parallel group trial, which was carried out over 2 years. One group was given 2 years of mycophenolate mofetil. The second group received 1 year of cyclophosphamide followed by 1 year of placebo. Now they found out that the cyclophosphamide and MMF both were a good and effective drug for a systemic sclerosis associated ILD. But MMF was told to be the drug of choice because it was a better tolerability among patients and the toxicity profile is also better. So let us now see the drugs. Mycophenolate mofetil, it is a drug of choice. It's an immunosuppressant, the dosage being around 500 mg BV for first 1 to 4 weeks, followed by a maintenance dose as much as patient tolerate, high up to 1500. Side effects include GI intolerance, leukopenia and opportunistic infection. So to avoid this, patients can undergo, can be given prophylactic PCP and antifungal medications, contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation, and requires monitoring of the CBC and LFT. The second drug is cyclophosphamide. It's an alkylating agent, a nitrogen mustard derivative. The dosage is 50 mg, starting at 2 mg per kg orally, or if you're giving IV, 600 mg per meter square. The adverse effect typical to cyclophosphamide includes hemorrhagic cystitis and bladder cancer. Very life-threatening and dangerous. So to avoid this, before giving an IV injection, kindly hydrate the patient well with 1 to 2 liters of NS. It is contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation, and monthly monitoring of CBC, LFT and urine analysis has to be done. Azathioprine, it is used as an alternative immunosuppressant only when cyclophosphamide and MMF is not tolerated by the patient. Initial dose includes 25 to 50 mg and then a CBC is done at 2 weeks. If the patient is not having any life-threatening neutropenia or leukopenia, then we slowly increase and bring it up to a maximum of 150 mg per day. Monitoring of CBC and LFT is to be carried out. Adverse effect includes bone marrow suppression, malignancy, infertility. Other drugs which have been used in some trials, nintedanib, as we all know, it is used in the treatment of IPF. It is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor. But a census trial which was published in 2019, they tried to give nintedanib to patients who's already been in MMF or cyclophosphamide but still has progression. So it was used as an add-on therapy and not as a monotherapy. The dosage was 150 mg BD and monitoring of LFT and ECG was done and required for this patient. And they found to have quite a benefit in these patients. Rituximab has also been tried in small observational clinical trials, basically as a rescue therapy for antisynthetase syndrome and not for the systemic ILD, which we usually see. Corticosteroids can also be given, but never as a monotherapy, can be given along with the cyclophosphamide. Pirfenidone has also been tried in LOTUS trial, wherein they gave high doses, as much as 2,400 mg of pirfenidone to check for tolerability, and it was found that it was very much tolerable in these patients, but it was a small study. Non-pharmacological management included smoking cessation, supplemental oxygen in patients with hypoxemia, vaccination, GERD management, and pulmonary rehabilitation. Our second important disease, rheumatoid arthritis. Even though commonly seen in females, the RA-ILD is more commonly seen in males, especially smokers. 60% of the patients of rheumatoid arthritis have some form of pleuroparenchymal involvement. 20% of them will come with primary lung manifestation before the articular manifestation. RA-ILD occurs in about 10% of these patients. The rheumatoid factor does not correlate or prognosticate the disease, but the anti-CCP levels is found to be correlated with the extent of the parenchymal involvement. Pleuroparenchymal complication is aggravated in patients who are coming with severe chronic articular disease, elevated rheumatoid factor at the point of presentation, presence of subcutaneous nodule, and associated with other systemic complications, including heart, like myocarditis, pericarditis, ocular inflammation, Felty syndrome, where you have splenomegaly and neutropenia associated with it, and also in smokers. Pulmonary manifestation. Almost 5 to 40% of these patients have interstitial lung diseases, most commonly males, most commonly smokers, and in a late onset disease. Common type is UIP followed by NSIP. Any pattern might be involved in these patients, but usually acute presentation is quite rare. Pleurisy and pleural diseases seen in about 5% patients can be unilateral, bilateral, self-resolving, and it is exudative type with high pleural fluid rheumatoid factor. Necrobiotic nodule. Even though it is all fancy telling that it's a rheumatoid nodule, it's quite rare. Hardly in 1% of the patient it is seen and usually present with active articular disease. Spontaneous resolution. Nothing needs to be done for it. When it is seen in association with the pneumoconiosis, it is called as Kaplan syndrome. Airway, upper or lower airway can be involved. Upper airway, when involved, involves the cricoarytenoid joint. Patient will have a global sensation, pain, self-resolving, or with analgesic and NSAIDs. Lower airways is also involved in the form of bronchiolitis. Pulmonary vascular disease is least common in these patients. When do you treat? Patients usually benefit if the patient has been diagnosed at a younger age, or if there is a sudden worsening over 3 to 6 months period, either by CT or by PFT or by symptom itself. Histological pattern, anything other than UIP can be treated easily and faster. Therapy to the joint disease has to be continued according to the rheumatologist orders. But given the mainstay of the treatment is DMARDs, which includes methotrexate, that will have to be discontinued once the patient is diagnosed specifically of ILD. Corticosteroid is a mainstay of treatment. 0.5 mg per kg per day as a single morning dose is given, maximum of 6 to 60 mg. It takes usually 1 to 3 months for the patient to respond. Failure to respond to corticosteroids, only then you can add immunosuppressive agents like azathioprine, MMF, and cyclophosphamide. As already told, DMARDs is usually avoided in patients with RA-ILD, especially methotrexate, because it causes something called as methotrexate-induced pneumonitis, which is not time-dependent or dose-dependent. Other drugs like sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, leflunomide can also be recommended, but never as a single agent. Newer agents like anti-TNF-alpha regimen also have been tried. Next, coming to SLE. SLE is notorious for its plethora of pleuroparenchymal manifestations. The Systemic Lupus International Collaborating Clinic classification has 11 clinical and 6 immunological criteria. At least one of them and 4 has to be positive. Apart from the only time when lupus nephritis is confirmed with the biopsy and anti-dsDNA antibodies come positive. So almost 97 to 98% of the patients will end up having some form of pulmonary manifestation. It is known to trigger something called as acute lung syndrome, which can either be community-acquired pneumonia, pleurisy, acute reversible hypoxemia syndrome, diffuse alveolar damage, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, or uremic pleuritis secondary to lupus nephritis. Most common type is NSIP treated with systemic steroid, 0.5 to 1 mg per kg per day. Immunosuppressive agents can also be given as a steroid-sparing agent. Acute lupus pneumonitis in less than 5% of the patient occurs, but it has a 50% mortality. Diffuse alveolar hemorrhage hardly occurs in 1-4%, but has a very high mortality rate. Lupus pruritus is usually self-resolving. It can be either unilateral or bilateral and usually recurrent. So nothing much needs to be done for these patients. Pulmonary vascular disease occurs in about 1-10% of the patient. It is associated with idiopathic pulmonary hypertension, which comes under Danapoint classification class 1. So these patients can be treated with vasodilator therapy. Bronchiolitis and respiratory muscle dysfunction is quite rare. It will also cause something called a shrinking lung syndrome, which is associated with the restrictive pattern in the PFT, right hemidiaphragm will be elevated and sudden onset breathlessness will be there. Our next disease will be Sjögren syndrome, which is a triad of xerophthalmia, xerostomia and polyarthritis. Two types, primary as a definition suggests, secondary when associated with other CTDs like rheumatoid arthritis. Pulmonary manifestation typical to Sjögren syndrome includes lymphocytic interstitial pneumonia, pseudolymphomas which may turn into malignancy, and treatment will involve corticosteroids or immunosuppressants. Polymyositis, it's an inflammatory myopathy, whereas the dermatomyositis specifically involves the skin in the form of heliotropic lashes and cotton papules. 40% of this patient will have some form of pulmonary manifestation, NSIP-ILD being the most common, but they also come with typically diffuse alveolar hemorrhage and diffuse alveolar damage. More commonly seen in females, and the amount of disease will be directly proportional to the anti-antibody levels in them. Corticosteroid and immunosuppressant is the mainstay of treatment. Aspiration pneumonia and respiratory muscle dysfunction is more commonly seen in these patients. Mixed connective tissue disorder. MCTD is nothing but there will be mixture of clinical features involving SLE, systemic sclerosis and polymyositis, along with high titers of anti-U1 ribonucleoprotein antibodies. Pulmonary manifestation, more than 50-60% of this patient will have some form of ILD, most commonly NSIP. Pulmonary vascular disease, pulmonary pleural diseases, aspiration pneumonia, respiratory muscle dysfunctions are also more commonly seen in these patients. So the take-home message of today's webinar will be, ILD can be presenting as a first manifestation of CTD, hence always a multidisciplinary approach is warranted. HRCT plays a very important role in early detection and is being used as a screening method now. When presented with a radiological pattern of NSIP or detection of lung cyst or coexistence of interstitial and parenchymal and bronchial pattern, always look for CTDs. CTD diagnosis is a diagnosis of exclusion. So whenever there is an ILD which is presenting in already known pre-existing CTD, please rule out all the other causes before you term them as ILD and give a diagnosis to a patient. Steroid is the mainstay of treatment in CTD-ILD, especially in a non-UIP pattern, except in systemic sclerosis where the drug will be MMF. Nintedanib has recently been approved of systemic sclerosis ILD with fibrosis, and the role of antifibrotics has also been used in the CTD fibrotic type of ILDs. Thank you.